Hello everyone, my name is Indrayani and I am Support Escalation Engineer here at Microsoft. I am partnering with my peer Ravi for this session. Today we are going to discuss about Exchange Online setup and managing mailboxes. So this session encompasses overview of Office 365 and Exchange Admin Center, different recipient types in Exchange Online, mailbox permission, and mailbox recovery scenarios. So let's get started. In today's session, we would be covering Admin Center dashboard as well as Exchange Admin Center. Along with that, we would be talking about mailbox permissions, type of mail object, recovery of mailboxes, followed by different troubleshooting scenarios. So let's get started with the Office Admin Center. This is the main home page where we have different tiles present and we can edit the home page and arrange it as the way we like. So these are the shortcut to various options or configuration settings. We can actually get them from the left hand side. We are able to see in the screenshot. So we have users, groups and other resources. We can perform tasks like adding a user. We can sort active users by columns like display name or licenses. So to add more, we select choose columns, select the columns we want to add, and then we click on save. Select a user to see more options like managing their product licenses. Then to enable more features that comes with your subscription, we have to click on setup. Here you can turn on sign-in security, mobile app protection, DLP, and other features included with your subscription. So these are the Admin Center features and settings which I just explained. We have like report, health dashboard, Admin Centers. So we have different admin centers for Exchange, Skype for Business, SharePoint, Yammer, Azure AD. So each admin center will include all available settings for that service. Like we take an example of Exchange Admin Center, we can set up and manage emails, calendars, distribution groups, and many more things. Likewise, in SharePoint Admin Center, we can create and manage site collections, site settings, and OneDrive for Business. Like in the Skype for Business Admin Center, we can set up instant messaging notifications, dial-in conferencing, and online presence. Then we have a report tab in the left pane. We can see a glance like how our organization is using Office 365. With the detailed reports on the email use, office activations, and many more things. Then we have setting tab from where we can manage global settings for apps like email, sites. Then we can change our password policy and expiration date. Then we can add and update domain names. We can change organization profile, release preferences, and can choose whether partners can actually access the admin center. So similarly, we have groups, resources. Groups are like where we can create and manage groups in our organization, like Office 365 group, distribution group, security group, shared mailboxes. Then resources from where we can manage resources like SharePoint site collection. Then we have a domain setup, like we can manage our domains. We can turn on and manage multi-factor authentication, manage admin access, migrate user mailboxes to Office 365, then manage feature updates. And also we can help users install the Office applications. So these are a few admin center features and settings. Now we'll move on to adding domain. So we must be a global administrator to add or modify or remove the domain. So here are the screenshots that I have added from the Exchange Admin Center, from Office 365 Admin Center. So basically we have to go to the settings domain page, and then we have to click on Add Domain. In the left pane in Microsoft 365 Admin Center, we are able to see this setting option. We just have to click on Add Domain in the middle pane to add a new domain. Then we have to enter the name of the domain that we want to add, and then we have to select Next. So verify the domain. We have to add, we can add TXT or MX record to our DNS provider. So we have to choose how you want to make the DNS changes required for Office to use your domain. So choose Add the DNS record if you want Office to configure your DNS automatically, or choose I'll add the DNS records myself if you want to attach only specific Office 365 services to your domain. Or if you want to skip this for now, then we can do this later as well. We have that option. Choose this option if you know exactly what you're doing. So if you choose to add DNS records yourself, then we have to select Next. And then we will see a page with all the records that you need to add to your registrar's website so that we can set up our domain. And then we have to click on Finish to complete the setup. So these screenshots will help us and give a better understanding. Now we'll move on to Exchange Online recipients. So we have different recipients in Exchange Online, like user mailbox, shared mailbox, mail contact, mail users, public folders. We have scheduling mailbox. So I'll explain few. Like user mailbox, it has an associated Active Directory account that gives the person access to the mailbox to send and receive email messages and create meetings and appointments in Exchange Online. So we have maximum of 100 GB of mailbox size assigned depending on the subscription we have. Shared mailboxes, basically it's not a group. However, it is used by a group of users. So if several users need to share access to a single mailbox, we would create a shared mailbox. So think of it like a specific group of users that needs to respond all as the same person. Well, then a shared mailbox will be perfect for that. So some users have ability to read the content of what's in the mailbox. Others may have full control and may be able to send and receive emails from that mailbox. So we have resource mailbox. We can create room or equipment mailboxes. They are not necessarily used for sending and receiving emails, but used for scheduling purposes. So if we have a conference room, we can give each of the room their own mailboxes, like we can schedule their usage so that we can check the availability of the room and can then schedule time for that room. Equipment mailbox also works in the same way. It's not just for the room, but for the laptop or the other equipments that the offices uses. So giving it an equipment mailbox, we can use it for scheduling purposes. Then we have mail contact, like Active Directory contact with an external email address. We basically don't give a mailbox for mail contact. We simply have the ability to send an email to that contact wherever that contact is. Similarly, mail users are Active Directory users with login credentials with an external email address. Then we have public folders, Office 365 group, security group. So public folders are designed for shared access and provide an easy and effective way to collect and organize and share information with other people in your work group or organization. So public folders help organize content in a deep hierarchy that's easy to browse. Public folder mailboxes contain the hierarchy information plus the content of the public folders. So we must first create public folder mailbox before creating public folders. Also, we have distribution group, which are used for message distribution. And they are static in the sense that you determine who will be in the group so that you can send email. It will be sent to multiple individuals in the group. Similarly, we have dynamic distribution group. Like their users filters to create group membership. Like if we have a specific attribute that can be used to filter the individuals that are in that group. So when you send email to that group, because it's dynamic, it determines the individuals in that group at that moment using various filters that we configured. And Office 365 group, it is used for collaboration between users inside and outside our organization. Then we have security group and mail enabled security group. So security group is used to assign permission to set of users to grant access to things like SharePoint site or entire SharePoint list or document or some files. And if we mail enable the security group, then we can send email to all the members of that group. Also, we have scheduling mailbox. So scheduling mailbox, it is used for bookings. So you can find who or how and what created it by looking in the audit logs. So the commandlet to look at for is new-mailbox-scheduling. So these are special type of mailboxes which are used by Microsoft bookings. So now we'll move to Exchange Admin Center. So these are the screenshots I captured from Exchange Admin Center, and we have the PowerShell screenshot, like we ran the PowerShell command and connected to Exchange Admin Center. Exchange Online, basically. So Exchange Online provides a single unified management console, which allows for ease of use and is optimized for management of on-prem, online, and hybrid deployments. So from Exchange Admin Center, administrators can manage Exchange-specific settings. Now we'll move to provisioning issues, which are caused by like wrong Exchange attributes and can be identified with the below symptoms. Like if you have recently migrated the users from on-premises and you assign them a license. But when the user is logging into Office 365 portal, he sees the Exchange app with setting up status. So we made some attribute changes in Active Directory for a user. Then example, like we have changed the primary SMTP and you notice that these changes do not reflect to Exchange Online. And also another possibility is some users that have been provisioned as remote mailboxes and are reporting that they are seeing setting up for OR people contact icons in Office 365 portal. But if they browse directly to OR through the URL, then they are able to access their emails like outlook.office365.com. So I have explained few scenarios like how to fix provisioning errors due to archive grid mismatch. So we come across an error like fail to sync the archive grid of mailbox because one cloud archive grid already exists. So this error usually occurs if we have an active online archive for that user in the cloud. But at the same time, this user is synced from Active Directory with another value for archive grid. Exchange Online cannot validate this value since it would mean to override the existing cloud archive grid. So depending on your on-premises configuration, there are three scenarios. Scenario one will be like if you have a hybrid environment, in order to fix the archive grid mismatch issue, we can run below command from the local exchange management shell. Set hyphen remote mailbox hyphen identity of the user, and we have to mention the archive grid. The archive grid will be the value of the cloud archive grid. So to find the value of the cloud archive grid, we have to connect to the Exchange Online PowerShell session, which I mentioned in the previous slide, the PowerShell commands. With the help of that, we have to connect to the Exchange Online PowerShell session, and we have to run the command get-mailbox identity of that user pipefl with the archive grid switch. So it will give basically the archive grid of that specific user mailbox. Now let's go to scenario two. So you no longer have an on-premise Exchange server in your organization, but you still have the Exchange attributes in your Active Directory schema. So from a domain controller, we have to open Active Directory PowerShell, and we have to run first the command import hyphen module Active Directory. Then to store the cloud archive grid in a variable, we have to mention the grid value, like value of the cloud archive grid. We have to assign it in a variable. And then we have to set the archive grid property with the help of command set hyphen ad user hyphen replace switch. Now let's go to scenario three. So you do not have any Exchange server in your organization, and you are also missing the Exchange attribute from your AD schema. So since the attributes that you need to change is MS Exchange archive grid, you won't have this attribute available on the Active Directory user attribute list. So therefore, the recommended option is to install an Exchange server with the client access role. So it will help you to extend the AD schema and will provide you access to Exchange Management Shell, from where we can edit any Exchange attribute. So once we have a local Exchange server, we can apply the fix from the scenario one, which we just discussed. So a few things to keep in mind before performing the above mentioned steps is, we have to make sure that the mail nickname attribute is being populated for the affected users in your Active Directory. So by design, AD Connect, Azure AD Connect uses a sync rule for Exchange attributes that is triggered only for the users with the mail nickname attribute which populated. So if you have to double check if this attribute is populated in Active Directory for the affected users, otherwise, any changes to the local Exchange attributes will not be synced to the cloud. Also, we have to check the AD Connect connectors configuration to confirm that the local Exchange attributes are included in the synchronization schema. Additionally, you might have to run again the Azure AD Sync configuration wizard just to update the sync configuration with the Exchange attributes, in case we have extended the AD schema. So just now we discussed about provisioning errors related to archive grid mismatch. Now we'll see provisioning errors related to archive grid or Exchange grid used by another recipient. So a value archive grid of is used by another recipient object, then it will give us, please specify a unique value. Also, the value of property archive grid is used by another recipient, then we exchange grid. Then we have to specify a unique value. So in order to fix this validation error, you will have to find the faulty user that is using the same grid. It can be another active user, but most likely it is a soft deleted mailbox or a soft deleted mail user. So once you found this object, you will have to purge it from the EXO directory so your affected user can be provisioned properly. So to resolve this type of issue, we have to first use this command to get the exchange grid or the archive grid. Get dash MSOL user, user principal name of that affected user, pipefl. So we in exchange online PowerShell for the object that is using the mentioned exchange grid or archive grid. So get dash recipient hyphen include soft deleted recipient switch and exchange grid value we have to mention. So once you found that the object that is using the exchange grid or archive grid, then we'll have to purge it. So if it is a soft deleted mail user, then we have to run remove hyphen mail user exchange grid value with the permanently delete switch. So if it is a soft deleted user mailbox, then we have to run the command remove hyphen mailbox, mention the exchange grid value with the permanently delete switch. So if this commandlet fails, then due to mailbox being protected by hold, then you have to disable the hold first. We have to make sure that data backup is done. So to make the changes, we have to run the command set hyphen mailbox, mention the email address of the mailbox. Then we have to run the litigation hold enable switch with a dollar false. And we have to mention the inactive mailbox switch. So if it turns to be an active mail user or mailbox that is using this exchange grid or archive grid, then you need to evaluate the option to purge that user. So after the faulty object has been purged from Exchange Online, we need to fix the validation error by forcing the object. So we have to run the command get-msol user, user principal name of the user, to find the object ID. Then redo hyphen msol provision user. From the above command, we got the object ID. So we have to mention that object ID. Then we have to run the next command to confirm if your validation error is fixed. So with the help of get-msol user, we'll come to know if the validation error is fixed. Now we'll move on to changing the user license assignment. So I'll take you to the screenshot which I have captured. So this is the page from where we can make the changes. So on the update license assignment page, we see that some checkboxes are unavailable. It indicates that the services that can't be changed because they are inherited from a group license. So we have to sign into the Azure portal using a license administrator account in your Azure AD org. Select the Azure Active Directory users and then open the profile page for that user for which you want to make the changes. Then select licenses. Then assignments to edit license assignment for the group or the user. The assignments page is where you can resolve license assignments conflicts. So select the checkbox for Office 365 E3 and ensure that at minimum all of the E1 services that are assigned to the user are selected. Then clear the checkbox for the Office 365 E1. And then click on save, so that there will not be any data loss. Here is the screenshot for the better understanding. Now we'll move on to mailbox permissions. So in Exchange, we have three different type of mailbox permissions: full access, send as, and send on behalf. So full access permission, it allows the delegate to open the mailbox, to view and add or remove the content from the mailbox. It doesn't allow the delegate to send messages from that mailbox. We can do it from Exchange Admin Center as well as from PowerShell. So through PowerShell, we have to first connect to Exchange Online and then run the command add-mailbox-permission. Mention the identity of the mailbox. Then we have to mention the delegate identity for the user. Access right will be full access, as we have to assign full access permission to the user on that mailbox. Another level of permission is send as. It allows the delegate to send messages as if they come directly from that mailbox or group. So there is no indication that the messages were sent by the delegate. The PowerShell command to add the send as permission is add-ad permission. Mention the identity of the mailbox or the group. Mention the delegate identity. Access right will be send as. Send on behalf, it allows the delegate to send the messages from that mailbox or group. So the from address of these messages clearly shows that the message was sent by the delegate on behalf of group or mailbox, so whatever we mention. However, replies to these messages are sent to the mailbox or the group, not to the delegate. So the PowerShell command to assign send on behalf permission is set-mailbox. Mention the mailbox identity with a switch grant send on behalf to. So PowerShell, so I have captured a screenshot of the mailbox permission tab from the Exchange Admin Center. So regarding mailbox permission, we come across scenarios like permissions are not working. So user would receive access denied error, or you don't have required permission, or folders cannot be expanded. Such type of issue we experience. So the cause of this such type of issues like permission has not been replicated might be a one cause. So what are the steps we have to perform? So we have to check via PowerShell if the required permission is assigned to the mailbox. We have to validate if the permissions are working in Outlook web app, if they are not working in Outlook client. Then we have to try removing the permission and re-add them back. Also, we can try to reconfigure the Outlook profile. So these are the few steps we can try to resolve the permission not working issue. Now we'll move on to RBAC roles, role-based access control permission model. So basically it is comprised of roles and role groups. So a role is defined by a set of tasks an Exchange administrator can perform. So because many administrators have numerous responsibilities, but they cannot be assigned role groups. So first thing we see under admin roles is the variety of role groups. Some of them are very specific to Exchange Online, like help desk admin role group as well as tenant admin role group. So rest of them are role groups you will find in Exchange on-prem, like compliance management, discovery management, and many more. So now I'll take you to the screenshot which I have captured from Exchange Admin Center. So now on the right hand side, we see the assigned roles. So each of these role groups have a variety of roles assigned to it. So far for compliance management, we have data loss prevention, retention management, and so on. For discovery management, which is one of the role group that you might want to assign to someone from legal, then we have assigned roles as legal hold or mailbox search. So if you have legal hold role, you have the ability to put the mailbox on legal hold. Also, mailbox search allows the individual, if they have this role assigned ability, to search a mailbox to perform e-discovery under organization management. We pretty much have all the roles listed here. if we see the screenshot. If I wanted to create additional role group, you can create and can determine the roles that is assigned to it and can assign members to that role group. So we can also add members to the existing role groups if you don't want to create a new role group. So some other things we have, like we have the ability to take an existing role group and copy it and make modifications to it. So if you look at the user roles, we will see that this is a little bit different. With user roles, we have the ability to assign this as default role assignment policy. So this is something that end user can get by default. But if you want to make changes, you wanted to create your own user roles, then you can click on the plus icon. You're able to see in the second screenshot. Through new policy, which information we can determine, like which information the end users can modify. So this just controls what they can and cannot modify. So Exchange Server includes several built-in role groups, each one providing permission to manage specific areas in Exchange Servers. So some role groups may overlap with others. Also, I explained to you few built-in role groups we have, like discovery management, organization management, recipient management, help desk management. Like help desk management, this role group by default, it enables members to view and modify the Outlook on the web options for the user in an organization. View only organization management we have, where administrators who are member of this management role group, they can view the properties of that object in the Exchange Online organization. Now we'll move on to Outlook web app policies. So Outlook web app policies, it controls the availability of the settings and the features in the Outlook on the web. So a mailbox can have only one Outlook on the web mailbox policy applied to it. Here I have marked with the arrow. From here we can see the Outlook on the web policy, which is enabled on the mailbox. We can create different policies for different type of users in our Exchange Online organization. So Outlook web app policies allows the ability to enable and disable few features like text messaging, UM, IM, unified messaging, instant messaging, to ensure folks get a lighter version of OWA. We can apply a policy that does not give them that premium client effect. Also, we can get the output of OWA policy through PowerShell, like get-OWA mailbox policy. So there are multiple parameters we have in the OWA policy. I have added the PowerShell screenshot, which will give us a clear understanding. Get-OWA mailbox policy, from where we can get a few parameters of OWA policy. I'll explain you a few parameters. So we have allowed file types, which specifies that the attachment file types, file extensions that can be saved locally or viewed from the Outlook on the web. Then we have a blocked file type parameter, which specifies a list of attachment file types that can't be saved locally or viewed from the Outlook on the web. Then allow copy contacts to device address book, which it specifies whether a user can copy the content of their contacts folder to a mobile device native address book when using Outlook on the web for devices. Then we have calendar enabled parameter, which specifies whether to enable or disable the calendar in the Outlook on the web. Then related to attachments, we have classic attachments enabled, which specifies whether users can attach local files as regular email attachments in the Outlook on the web. So these are few parameters of OWASP policy. So we come across few issues related to OWASP mailbox policy. Like while running the command remove hyphen OWASP mailbox policy, user gets the error, couldn't delete the OWASP mailbox policy because it's associated with the user. So the cause for this can be, it could happen if a user has a mailbox which is having a ghost policy assigned to it before, and then the mailbox was removed without deleting the user. So the OWASP mailbox policy attribute is not cleared on the AD user object when the mailbox was removed. So few steps we can perform here. We have to check if there are users without mailbox. Then if there are just a few of them, complete the below steps like add a mailbox to a user, remove the reference of the policy, remove mailbox for the user. So these are the few steps we can perform if a users are present without mailbox and we are experiencing this OWASP mailbox policy error when we are trying to remove it. Now we'll move on to mailbox recovery scenarios. So we'll take here a cloud only and hybrid scenarios. Let's move on to cloud only workflow. If we have a MSO user in an active state, then his mailbox will be in active state in Exchange Online. If a MSO object is in recycle bin, then the mailbox will be in soft deleted state. And if the MSO object will be in permanently delete state, then the mailbox will be in inactive state. So this is the cloud workflow. If we talk about hybrid workflow, then we'll have an on-prem server added. So on-prem, we have an AD active object, then MSO active object. Then in MSO, we'll have an user in active state. Then in Exchange Online, mailbox will be in active state. So if in on-prem, we have an object in recycle bin, then MSO object will be in recycle bin and mailbox will be in soft deleted state. If in on-prem we have an AD object which is permanently deleted, then mailbox will be in recycle bin, MSO object will be in recycle bin and mailbox will be in soft deleted state. If we have an MSO object permanently deleted, like AD object permanently deleted, MSO object permanently deleted, then mailbox will be in inactive state. So we came to know about four states of mailbox, like active state, soft deleted user mailboxes, inactive mailboxes, hard deleted user mailboxes. So these are the states of the mailbox. So a soft deleted user mailbox is a mailbox that has been deleted using the Office 365 Admin Center or remove hyphen mailbox commandlet in the Exchange Management shell and has still been in the Azure Active Directory recycle bin for less than 30 days. So a soft deleted user mailbox is a mailbox that has been deleted in the following cases, like a user's mailbox associated Azure Active Directory user account is soft deleted. Like the Azure Active Directory user object is out of scope or is in the recycle bin container. Then second case can be a user mailbox associated Azure Active Directory, but the Exchange Online mailbox hasn't been in the soft deleted state for at least 30 days. then the user mailbox associated Azure Active Directory user account has been hard deleted, but the Exchange Online mailbox is in litigation hold or e-discovery hold. If a user mailbox is hard deleted from the Azure Active Directory, the mailbox will be in soft deleted in Exchange Online and will stay in soft deleted state for 30 days. So if in 30 days time period, a new Azure Active Directory user mailbox or mail user with the same Exchange GUID is created, then this will result in an Exchange GUID validation conflict error. So what I mean by inactive mailbox? So a mailbox becomes inactive when a litigation hold or an in-place hold is placed on the mailbox before the corresponding Office 365 user account is deleted. Then we have hard deleted user mailboxes. Hard deleted user mailbox is a mailbox that has been deleted in the following cases, like a user mailbox that has been soft deleted for more than 30 days and the associated Azure Active Directory user has been hard deleted. So check out the remove-msol user commandlet. All the mailbox content such as emails, contacts and files will be permanently deleted. So user mailbox has been hard deleted in the Azure Active Directory. The user mailbox is now in soft deleted in Exchange Online and stays in the soft deleted state for 30 days. But if in the 30 days time period, a new Azure Active Directory user mailbox or mail user with the same Exchange GUID is created, then this will result in the hard deletion of the original user mailbox. So like all mailbox content such as emails, contacts and files will be permanently deleted. The user mailbox has been hard deleted from the Azure Active Directory recycle bin or has been deleted using the remove-mailbox with the permanently delete switch commandlet in the Exchange Management shell. So these above scenarios assume that the user mailbox isn't in any type of hold states like litigation hold or e-discovery hold. So if there is any type of hold on the user mailbox, the mailbox can't be removed from the Exchange Online. For all mail user recipient types, litigation hold or e-discovery hold are ignored and have no impact on the mail user's hard deleted or soft deleted behavior. So the mail user object can't be deleted if there is any journal mailbox associated. Also, we can't disable journaling on the mail user by using the command disable journal archiving commandlet. So now we'll talk about restore scenarios. First, we'll take example of Exchange Online. So restore a user account which was removed from the portal of PowerShell using remove-msol command. Second will be restore a mailbox which was removed from EAC or PowerShell using remove-mailbox commandlet. First was remove-msol and this is remove-mailbox commandlet. So for Exchange Online scenario, we use PowerShell to restore a user account. We can recover the soft deleted mailboxes using the PowerShell commandlet. First, we have to connect to Exchange Online PowerShell and run the undo-soft deleted mailbox commandlet. So previously in Exchange Online, if you removed an Exchange Online license, the user was kept, but the mailbox user was transformed into a mail user and the mailbox was removed to the recycle bin. You could then recover the mailbox within the 30 days time period. This has now changed in Exchange Online. So if you remove a user's license, the user mailbox will no longer be able to sign in and use the Exchange Online and Office 365. The user mailbox will remain in Exchange Online until it is deleted or permanently removed or purged by the Office 365 admin. You can reassign a license to the user and can make the mailbox active again. So to restore a user account that was removed from the portal or PowerShell using remove-msol commandit. So deleting the MSO object puts the attached active mailbox in the soft deleted state. We can use restore-msol user commandit to recover the MSO object. And as we recover the MSO object using this command, the related mailbox is automatically restored in the active state. This is how to restore a user account which was removed with the help of commandlet remove-msol. So how to restore a mailbox which was removed from Exchange Admin Center or PowerShell using remove-mailbox commandlet. So removing the mailbox from Exchange Online also soft deletes the related MSO object. We can restore it using undo-soft-deleted mailbox commandlet. This will restore the mailbox and the soft-deleted MSO object in Azure AD. This command also create a new user and attach the mailbox to it on the condition the old related MSO object is still present in the soft-deleted state. So this is the command undo-soft-deleted mailbox. We can create a new user and can attach if we have an old MSO object present in our soft-deleted state. So now let's talk about restoring a deleted user's mailbox data to a newer alternate mailbox. So there could still be times when soft recovery actions will not fix the user account. So for instance, the user may have a corrupt account or the account may have been permanently deleted. Another possibility is that the user is no longer with the company, but the mailbox is used as a job-related mailbox and needs to be available to a user. So for these scenarios, we have the new-mailbox-restore-request commandlet. This allows you to merge the data from one user or archive mailbox to another user. Or you can archive the active mailbox. So unlike the recovery process above, like which is the best approach, new-mailbox-restore-request allows you to merge the data from a soft deleted mailbox into an alternate active mailbox or an archive mailbox. So why is this a benefit? Like previously, if you could not recover both the user and the mailbox, you would have to perform an unsupported process of hard deleting a mailbox. So this process was unreliable and sometimes caused a ripple effect on other services such as SharePoint or Link. So now if the process failed, you were left with very limited options and ultimately had to call support. So these steps help us to restore a deleted user mailbox to a new mailbox or an alternate mailbox. So in hybrid scenario, we create a user and a remote mailbox. We run the force AD sync. Then we collect the GUID for the soft deleted or the inactive mailbox. We get the GUID with the help of command get-mailbox with the soft deleted mailbox switch. And we specify the GUID value. We get the GUID value with the help of this commandlet. Then run the below commandlet, that is new-mailbox-restore-request to merge the accounts. So we have to specify here the source mailbox. We have to mention here the GUID, which we just got from the above commandlet. We have to mention the target mailbox GUID, which we'll get from the new mailbox with the allow legacy DN mismatch switch. So this switch specifies that the operation should continue if the legacy exchange DN of the source physical mailbox and the target mailbox don't match. So you don't need to specify a value with this switch. So by default, this commandlet checks to make sure that the legacy exchange DN on the source physical mailbox is present on the target user in the form of legacy exchange DN or an X500 proxy address that corresponds to the legacy exchange DN. So this check prevents you from accidentally restoring the source mailbox into the incorrect target mailbox. So now we'll talk about restoring an inactive user mailbox. So for those that may not know, an inactive mailbox is a mailbox associated with a user that was placed on litigation hold and then deleted. So in order to preserve the data and keep it searchable, we retain the mailbox contents and allow you to reuse the license that was previously assigned to the deleted user. So we have a scenario like inactive mailbox associated with the user that was placed on litigation hold and then was then deleted. So if you accidentally delete a user that was on litigation hold and you need to restore the user, then below are the steps that we need to follow. We have to run the command get-mailbox from and mention the UPN of the inactive mailbox with that inactive mailbox only switch. From this, we'll get the name, display name, Microsoft Online Service ID, exchange grid. Then we have to run the command mailbox. So here we have to mention name inactive mailbox and all attributes which we just got from the above commanded get-mailbox. Then after replication between Exchange Online and Azure AD, we will need to assign an Exchange Online license. So after running the above command, we would then create a new remote mailbox from Exchange On-Prem. We need to make sure that the SMTP address of the new remote mailbox is same as the SMTP address of the user that was restored. So these steps will ensure that the soft matching process goes through. So now I'll request my colleague Ravi to please explain about few scenarios which we come across.
Hello everyone. Now we will discuss key scenarios regarding the mailbox issues, the general troubleshooting steps, and the logs that needs to be collected. Moving on to the first scenario. We see that whenever we use URLs in the email messages on the Outlook web, we don't see that the URL is rendered and the preview of that URL is not shown in the email. This is one of the common scenarios that we see, which comes up as cases with Microsoft. To address this issue, there are two main attributes that we look into, one at the organization level and the second one at the mailbox configuration level. So the attribute is called link preview enabled, and this can be found at the organization level and can be set to true and false, which controls the action at the entire org level or at the individual mailbox level. So in case you see any single user not able to see the preview of the URLs, you can go at the individual mailbox configuration level, set this link preview enabled attribute to true, and then if the entire organization is affected with this issue, then you can verify the organization configuration and identify if the whole organization has been disabled to preview those URLs in the email. Once you have these values to true, the incoming emails should automatically preview any URLs which are part of the email body. Let's move on to the next scenario. In this scenario, let's see that every user, whenever they log into OWA, they see some or the other options missing, or whenever they click on any of those user options, they get a message telling that this option has not been enabled. Usually, the OWA options which are loaded for the users after they log on are controlled at the server level with respect to the configuration and the options that are allowed for the specific user. So whenever we track the OWA log on, once the login is initiated, there are other calls which are made where the server responds with the details for what configuration need to be loaded for the user once the login page is loaded. So if we track the fiddler traces, we will see a function called as get allowed options, which is made by the OWA client, and the server responds with different options that are enabled for the user. The most common ones being the birthday calendar enabled, my base options, which controls most of the user's configuration, where the user can himself go ahead and modify different settings with respect to the mailbox up to a certain level. One of the common scenarios being his signature, sweep rules, etc. So this my base options is a user RBAC role and not an admin RBAC role. So every user mailbox that is created in the Exchange Online will be assigned with a default user assignment role, and that will contain the role called as my base option, which has multiple role entries to control the mailbox configuration by the user himself. So once you see that these options are missing, make sure that you go back and verify that the default role assignment policy for the user is set to proper roles, and my base option is enabled, which manages these configurations for the mailbox. In case you see my base option is disabled, then most of the functions which user himself can manage in respect to the rules, sweep rules, etc. will be disabled for the user. So now let's move on to the next scenario. In this common scenario where user configure rules on their mailboxes, and sometimes we see those, they complain that these rules don't work as they expect it to. So with respect to rules, we have multiple categories like the server side rules and the client side rules. The server side rules are managed on the Exchange server level, where the server can perform certain defined actions as per the rule. And the client side rules or the Outlook rules, where you define the actions using the Outlook. And whenever the client is active, that means the Outlook is open, the rule gets triggered and the operation will be performed. So most of the times we see that there is a combination of the server side and the client side rules available with the user configuration or the configuration that is set up by the user on their mailboxes. So whenever we want to troubleshoot, we need to understand whether it's a server side rule or the client side rule that we are trying to troubleshoot. Also, there are a number of predefined set of conditions where the redirect rule or the forward rule works. So we need to understand that only these rules will be acting upon the emails that reach the inbox only once at a time. So whenever the new email hits and you have a redirect, forward or auto reply, it hits the mailbox and the rule will be applied once. Also, there is a maximum limitation on the number of recipients that can be configured for the inbox rules, and that is being limited to 10 at this point. Also, one main condition is if you have mentioned any mailbox with an inbox rule, and that mailbox is set as journaling report NDR2 in the organization, then no rules would apply or no inbox rules would work on that mailbox. So be sure that in case you are troubleshooting and see an opportunity where journaling report NDR is set to one of those mailboxes which is affected, make sure you switch that to a separate mailbox so that the current mailbox can have all the inbox rules working. Also, with respect to the rules not working, we have multiple ways to collect the logs. One is to do a live troubleshooting where you can send the email, understand what are the properties and the defined actions, verify manually if it's meeting those set of conditions, and then understand why the rule is triggered or not triggered. The other way to look at is we have an inbuilt feature to get a diagnostic report on these set of rules that are set up. This can be found in the Outlook web app. So once you sign in, you can go to the settings page, and under the options where we see inbox rules, you can verify there is a link called if the rules do not work, please click here to generate a diagnostic report. So once you click on this, it will automatically shoot an email containing different diagnostic information about the inbox rules. Most of them being the view state configuration, the current user options that the user has selected, the XML report of the inbox rules itself that are active and inactive, and if there are any bulk actions that was performed by the inbox rules, and any filter folder configurations that have been set up on the mailbox, and the sweep rule logs. So once you have all this information, you can verify what are the different errors that have occurred when the inbox rules are being actioned on the mailbox. With these logs in place, we will be able to identify or track down to a point that why a specific rule was not triggered, or why it was triggered but the action was not completed. Now let's move on to the next scenario. In this scenario, we have a very common problem where users have their mailbox. They manage it by manually deleting the emails or have MRM configured to delete their emails. But once this configuration is in place, they are not able to delete the emails from their mailbox. Whenever they attempt to delete an email, it appears to be deleted. And the next second when the page is reloaded, the email appears back in the same folder where it was deleted from. Even though the operation looks like it is completed, but on the back end, the operation was incomplete and hence the changes were reverted and the email is seen back. This usually happens in case there is a cached mode Outlook and there is an issue with the OST synchronization. Or else, if that is not the case, then we see one more common cause for this is where the recoverable items folder being full. And whenever you delete the email, that email has to be stored under the recoverable items folder. And due to the quota limitation at this point, the emails are not being stored and hence the operation is reverted back. In Exchange Online, there are soft limits and hard limits for the recoverable items and the deleted items folders. Also, in case we have enabled holds, these quotas are completely different so that the huge volume of email can be held within the mailbox after they are hard deleted or soft deleted. So usually when we put a mailbox on hold, litigation hold, in place hold, etc., the quotas for the recoverable items folder are moved up to 90 GB and 100 GB respectively. So with this holds in place and huge quotas, any items that are deleted will continue to stay in the mailbox and can be recovered whenever it's required. But in case that is not the scenario where you don't have any holds and your quota is very limited, then you come back and see the same symptoms where we are not able to delete the emails. This not only affects the manual deletion where the user is trying to remove the email from the mailbox, but also the MRM whenever it tries to process the mailbox and take actions specified by the retention policy or the retention tag. And if there are any policies where it has to delete the item or purge the item from the mailbox, it is unable to continue that operation. So whenever you go ahead and get a diagnostic report for the MRM, you can see specifically that there is an exception which is raised that the quota is full and hence MRM is not able to continue its operation. So for such scenarios, we have an option where you can empty the recoverable items folder. There are multiple ways you can do that, but in case you have litigation hold and in place hold, your organization might have to think on how and how much of the data you want to manage or remove from the mailbox. So moving on to the resolution for this, we see that in case there are no holds, we can use multiple tools like MFC Mappy, EWS Editor, etc. to go ahead and manually remove those items from the recoverable items folder and hence get some space for the deletion action to continue. Else, we have other options like search and delete using the PowerShell, where the functions are very limited because of the amount of resources that it might consume in case we issue a huge delete operation. So usually the search hyphen mailbox has a delete parameter with it, which can be used. Else we can use the compliance case action and purge few items from the mailbox. But as informed, these actions might be throttled and might not be very efficient in getting these items removed. So the MFC Mappy tool works wonders in such situations. In case there is no option to use MFC Mappy, administrators can use EWS Editor, get the configuration for the mailbox enabled on the EWS Editor, access the recoverable items, and then go ahead and purge those items from the mailbox. So that would be the options we use to resolve these issues. With that being the last slide, we have come to the end of the session, and thank you very much for listening to this session.